Hi, I'm Torben Janssen from thoughtsonjava.org. In this tutorial video, I will talk about the builder pattern and how you can use it with Hibernate. But before we start, if this is your first time here and you want to learn how to create your entity mappings with ease, build incredible efficient persistence layers with Hibernate and all types of other Java persistence related stuff, start now by subscribing and clicking the bell so you don't miss anything. And if you want to learn about any specific topic related to Hibernate, JPA, or Spring, let me know in the comment section below. When I shared an article about implementing the Fluent interface pattern on Twitter, I got asked about using the builder pattern for your entities. So I will do that in this video. Implementing the builder pattern for your entities can massively improve the readability of your business code. In contrast to the Fluent interface pattern, there's nothing in the JPA specification or the Hibernate documentation that prevents you from implementing a builder for an entity class. But implementing a good builder for your entities requires some additional thoughts. You need to do more than only provide builders that create a simple object. You need to cascade your builders to provide an API that makes it easy to build a graph of entities. Let's create builders to create an order with multiple order items comfortably. Each order item references a product from the product catalog. Without a builder, the code to create an order with two order items looks like this. That code isn't complicated, but it's long, technical, and not very easy to read. You can improve that by either providing a Fluent interface or by implementing a builder. The easiest approach to create a builder API for your entities would be to implement a builder for each entity class. But that API wouldn't provide a lot of benefits compared to the constructor and setter methods that I used in the previous example. A meaningful builder API needs to help you to create a graph of entity objects. For example, in this video, that means that you not only need to provide a builder for the order and the order item entity, you also need to support the creation of a set of order item objects for a given order. If you do that, you will be able to create a new order with two order items like this. Okay, let's take a look at the code of the builder classes in the IDE. The order entity is the root of the small graph of entities. When you create an order object, you can ignore the primary key and the version attribute. These are generated attributes that you don't need to provide when you instantiate a new object. When you ignore these attributes, there are only two attributes left: the order date of type localDate and a set of order item entities. Due to that, you only need to provide a withOrderDate, with items, and a buildOrder method to be able to build an order entity object. Within these methods, you can perform additional validations, for example, check that the order date isn't in the past or that the set of order item isn't empty. They also enable you to hide technical details. I used that in the build order method to hide the double linking between the order and order item objects that's required to manage the bidirectional one-to-many association. Technically, we don't need any additional methods. But as you can see in the code snippet, I also implement the withItems method that returns an order item list builder and doesn't take any order item entities as parameters. The withItems method and the order items builder class make the API much easier to use because you can use them to create a new order item object and add them to the order. The order item list builder class bridges the gap between the order and the order item builder by managing the set of order items. In contrast to the two other builders in this example, this class doesn't implement any logic. It only provides the required glue code so that you can chain the method calls required to create multiple order items and to add them to an order. There are two important things that I want to point out. The reference to the order builder that gets provided as a constructor parameter. The buildItemList method that you need to call to get back to the order builder when you are done adding order items to the set. The order item builder implements the required methods to build an order item. The only method that's not strictly required is the addToList method. It creates a new order item object and returns the order item list builder so that you can keep adding order items to the set. After you've seen the code of the three builder classes, let's take another look at the business code that creates an order with two order items. In the first line, I instantiate a new order builder, which I then use to provide the date of the order. Then I want to add order items to the order. To do that, I first call the withItems method. It returns an order item list builder on which I call the addItem method to get an order item builder that's linked to the order item list builder. After I've set the reference to the product entity and the quantity that the customer wants to order, I call the addToList method. That method builds an order item object with the provided information and adds it to the set of order items managed by the order item list builder. The method also returns the order item list builder object that allows me to either add another order item to the set or to call the build item list to complete the creation of the set. In the final step, I call the build order method on the order builder to create the order method. Within that method, a new order object gets created, the set of order items gets filled, and each order item gets associated with the order entity. After I've created the order object, I provide it as a parameter to the persist method of the entity manager. I've set the cascade type of the order items association to persist so that Hibernate automatically persists the associated order item entities when I persist the order entity. You can easily apply the builder pattern to your entities. In contrast to the fluent interface pattern, you don't need to work around any technical requirements defined by the JPA specification or the Hibernate documentation. To implement a good builder API, you need to cascade your builders so that you can comfortably create one or more associated entities. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join the free Thoughts on Java library. It gives you free access to a lot of member-only content, like a cheat sheet for this video and an ebook about using native queries with JPA and Hibernate. I'll add the link to it to the video description below. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!